Hello, everyone, and welcome to Channel 781 News. This week in Waltham, the City Council approved the mayor's recommended budget of approximately $313 million for the city, including about $98 million for the schools. That's a 5% increase over last year in terms of the overall budget and the school budget. However, the school budget significantly less than that earlier budget that was discussed of $101 million that was discussed back in April. So we'll tell you more about how that came about. We'll also talk about in the Public Works and Public Safety Committee meeting, there was some discussion of MBTA bus routes and a possibility of buying property for flood mitigation. In the Licenses and Franchises Committee, they had National Grid in and they had a conversation about naming a bridge. I want to tell you about some exciting work being done by two people in the community, Alex Green and Maria Varmazis. And also something we just learned about a business called Pino's Tattoos, Pino Brothers Tattoos. I am Josh Kastorf and I'm here with James Krikelis.
Hi, everyone.
Chris Gamble is away tonight, so it's just the two of us. We would have loved to have a guest on to talk about all the school budget issues, but that's difficult because people who work for the school, it's a sensitive subject. So we're going to try to summarize that for you. Our email address is walthamdata@gmail.com. I will put it up on the bottom of the screen. And I mentioned that's a good way to get in touch with us. You can also message us through social media, but if you want to email us, that's the best email. I say that because there have been a lot of times on the show where if I ask people to get in touch with us to help out with various things, but I haven't always been clear about how to do that. Also because apparently somebody sent a comment about our show to Waltham Watch News, which is not affiliated with our show, although I do recommend checking them out. For those who don't know, Waltham Watch News is a local news blog that's mostly satirical, but also has some really interesting non-satirical articles sometimes. And so I'm a fan, but they have nothing to do with our show. So if you have comments on our show, please send them to walthamdata@gmail.com. Last week on Wednesday, there was a budget hearing. This was the series of budget hearings that the Finance Committee sends up each year, where they go through the mayor's proposed budget. They ask questions of the mayor or the department head or both, and then they have a chance to cut the budget. And this goes on partly in their usual Tuesday night meeting time, but also in some long meetings during the day. So they have time to go through all 29, I think, sections of the city budget. So last Wednesday, the school budget was discussed. As you may remember, the Waltham Educators Association had put out a request for people to contact both the city council and the school committee to ask them to possibly support an earlier number that was presented by the superintendent, $101 million, as opposed to the 98 that the mayor was recommending and that the superintendent is now recommending. So apparently they were successful in getting a lot of people to email the council and the school committee. The councilors mentioned it several times in this meeting. And in this meeting, they had the superintendent in and they grilled him for over 2 hours. He was on his feet facing intense critical questioning, both from the counselors on the finance committee and some additional counselors who were there for this meeting. And as Councilor LaCava, who's the chair of the finance committee, explained that they're doing this because this is their only chance to question the superintendent. And even though the city council has a minimal role in the schools, people have been asking them questions about the schools, raising issues with the schools, and this was their only chance to talk about it. So they discussed a number of very serious and very important issues with the schools. However, none of them said that they would have been willing to spend more money to solve those issues. Councillor Paz was the only one who said that he would have supported the earlier $101 million budget and that he was concerned even that wasn't enough. All the other councillors had critical questions for the superintendent, and some of them were very valid, and some of them came across a little bit as grandstanding because they were expressing outrage without necessarily supporting a solution. So after the superintendent was done being grilled, the mayor gave her presentation as to how she came up with this budget, why this is the right number. And she basically explained that city revenue is expected to go up 5% in the next fiscal year. That city revenue excluding certain departments, which are considered self-funding enterprises. And since the revenue is going up 5%, the total city budget is going up 5%. So therefore the school system budget needs to also go up 5% relative to last year. She then had to rush over to, because the school committee, the Wednesday night school committee meeting was already started. So she and the WCAC cameraman had to rush over to the school and do that meeting. And in that meeting, Mr. Turallo made a last minute attempt to try to asked the school committee to reconsider the budget. That's not something you would normally do at this point in the process because they've already voted on it, but I didn't watch this meeting, but I'm told he cited a law that allowed him to make a motion about it, and he made a motion, he didn't get a second. So none of the other school committee members were willing to support reconsidering the budget. So then this week on Tuesday night, the finance committee met again to finish up their discussions. They voted without any cuts except the mayor's budget. And so later the same evening, there was a special meeting of the city council where they voted also to approve that budget, and two people voted against it. Councillor Paz, who said that he felt that the schools were underfunded, as well as the health department and the engineering department. Councillor Bradley MacArthur voted no, citing the schools being underfunded. She said she thought they were about $2 million under where they should be, and that building a new high school without funding the people inside it is like building an airplane with no pilot. And so they made a gesture, but they were outvoted, and the budget is now a done deal. We can go back and talk a little bit more about some of those details. But first, James, did you have any comment on that?
Yeah, thank you. I just broadly, and just like a general critique that I think is fair to level, but it's just that when it comes to funding stuff like the school, and buying stuff in general for it, it seems like it's a lot easier to buy things for one-off expenses, like buying an expensive new school building. And that also happens to make a lot of work for construction companies and, you know, police details and stuff like that. However, there's a lot less money for, you know, recurring expenses like paying teachers well and making sure you've got like well-equipped staff that are happy in their jobs and happy with what they're getting compensated. All of the focus is on, you know, how can we follow the norms when it comes to approving the school budget?
Thank you. Yeah, that's another thing that I noticed in this process is the question of what was reasonable for the school budget was framed as relative to other departments, relative to last year, relative to income. Not much of the discussion that I saw focused on, is this enough money to fulfill our responsibility to the students? And so I want to talk a little bit more about the hearing from last week and some of the attitudes that came up in it. So if you're somebody who is frustrated with problems in the school and you want to see the superintendent held accountable, I definitely recommend checking out the video of this meeting on the WCAC website. If you were someone who was hoping that the council would do what the Waltham Educators Association asked and support a higher budget, it was pretty disappointing. As I mentioned, there was only Councillor Paz was in favor of that. The meeting started off with Councillor LaFosse questioning the superintendent in a very tough, maybe angry kind of way. He raised some issues in the school that were then other councillors like LaCava and others followed up on, mostly having to do with safety and discipline in the schools. One of the issues he raised was that they have these really long periods, 80-minute periods in their current schedule. And one of those is hot block, which is for extracurriculars, but for some kids, they don't have anything to do during it. And they also have staffing problems, like many schools do. So sometimes there's no teacher for a class and no substitute, and the kids have nothing to do for 80 minutes. And if you have two teachers out, that's a pretty big chunk of the day. So what happens is kids leave, and it's not officially an open campus, but a court, you know, at least the counselor's perception was it's a de facto open campus because the staff just can't prevent this many kids from leaving when they have nothing for them to do at school. The other issue that was raised was that there have been sexual assaults in the school, one reported at the middle school and one reported at the high school. And some counselors perceive that there actually may be a lot more of that that's not being reported. Another issue was fires. Again, there was one reported at the high school, one reported at the middle school, and some counselors perceived that there were actually more than that that weren't reported. So those safety issues are definitely very valid issues that need to be discussed. It's hard for me to say how much responsibility the superintendent bears in that, but I'd be interested to hear from people who are more connected to the schools and watch this, what they thought of it. Another thing that came up was the high dropout rate, especially among English students who are learning English as a second language. And Counselor Vidal brought that up. And he said it was a disgrace. And that was actually really interesting because he's not someone who often stands up for the immigrant community explicitly in that way. So that was significant that he said that, although he wasn't recommending spending money to fix it. Counselor Paz also brought up that issue. There was a program, which I believe was called Student Opportunity Institute. I'm sorry if I'm getting the name wrong, but it was a program that started this past year that was supposed to help second language students get sort of the extra resources they need to graduate. And I believe it was recommended by staff members who came up with it, and it didn't work out. It actually stopped work. It was dropped halfway through the year. And this came up in the school committee meetings because when Mr. Torello suggested a night school, he felt there needed to be an immediate replacement of some kind for this program. And others on the school committee felt, no, first we need to figure out why that program failed and then build something that's gonna work. So counselors explicitly asked the superintendent, why did it fail? And he said it failed because it was unfunded. That basically it was a plan to try to address these issues without asking for more money. And so it was teachers who already had responsibilities and administrators who already had other responsibilities were supposed to run it, and they got burnt out and they had to drop it. Counselor Paz questioned that. He said that from what he was hearing, it failed because it was not a priority for the superintendent himself. Counselor LaCava then made an interesting comment when he started his questioning. I just want to make sure I'm not misrepresenting him, so we're going to show you the clip of that.
In terms of the dropout rate, I think some may be afraid to say it, and I don't think that number reflects the school. I don't think it's your fault. I think it's a system-wide, whether it be state or federal. That's the fault of a lot of these students. They start their schooling knowing the exact date they're stopping. It's a pathway to citizenship. It's a pathway to be here legally. And they have no intentions of finishing their schooling. And they have every intention of just not breaking the law. And I do speak to students of that demographic. I do know it. And I want to say I don't blame you for a lot of the dropouts.
I kind of feel bad criticizing Counselor LaCava because for the whole rest of the hearing, he really came across as really decent. He was the one who was acknowledging this was tough for the superintendent and offering to give him breaks and stuff. But I think this comment really needs to be addressed. I think that if Counselor LaCava, if it was his kid or his friend's kid who had just started ninth grade and they said to him, I already know what date I'm allowed to drop out and that's when I'm dropping out, I think he would probably ask him why, you know, why have you given up on graduating? And there's a lot of different possible answers. But if the kid said it's because I don't feel safe at school or I don't feel like I have any chance of graduating with the resources there. I think he would probably see that as an issue with the school. And the fact that if an immigrant kid says the same thing, he's saying that's not our issue, that's the federal, that's an immigration policy issue. That was the fault of someone who allowed that kid to be here or made those rules about having to stay in school for a certain amount of time. Which makes sense until you remember that we're talking about kids. They didn't have a choice to come here. They don't have a choice to be in school. And the reason we're educating them is not to give them a benefit that immigrants are somehow less entitled to. The reason we're educating them is because they're part of the future of our community. We want to live in a community of educated people. So they don't do things like elect a con artist as president or, you know, ignore a catastrophe because they don't understand the science. And it doesn't matter where a kid is coming from. All that matters is that they're a part of our community in the future. And that's the underlying idea of public education that I think gets lost in some of these discussions. There was also an interesting comment where the superintendent was asked, what were the drivers of enrollment? And he listed as one of the drivers of enrollment as opening up of the border. So that seemed like a kind of a similar attitude. Councillor LaCava also made a comment where he said that he was concerned that social emotional learning is causing there to be fewer consequences for bad behavior, and that's leading to safety issues in the school. That was kind of odd because social emotional learning is a broad type of curriculum that means a lot of different things, but it's one of those things that is being attacked right now in right-wing Facebook groups, similar to CRT, and where they have a certain idea of what it means that's very malevolent and is not really in line with what it means in the school. So it kind of made it sound like maybe Councillor LaCava has been spending time in some right-wing Facebook groups. So I hope he will spend less time doing that and spend more time talking to immigrant kids in the city and finding out why it is that they've given up on graduating. And I think you'll find that a lot of it has to do with people needing to work. And the solution is to provide opportunities to do school at a different time of day. And we're not doing that in this budget. That's not happening. It might be in a future budget, but for this year, kids who are here now don't get that. I'm going to leave it there. James, did you have any comments?
Yeah, I was going to say, one of the things was just that you talked about the burnout of a program that was basically being run by volunteers, and then that somehow getting spun as, oh, not the superintendent's priority. I mean, with a lot of these things, like, if money talks, like, if there's no funding, it's clearly not being prioritized. And this sounds like it was some sort of, like, you know, Hail Mary to try to get around the fact that the city, that there wasn't funding for a program that it sounds like is desperately needed. And then also related to the, like, you know, stuff that circulates in right-wing Facebook groups. This isn't like the first time even this year that that has, you know, bubbled to the surface in our schools. And part of it is just because, like, they're very clearly getting targeted for, you know, moving what would be public funds towards private institutions and going after things like the CRT and gender inclusive education and now like emotional learning leading to behavior issues. It just all seems like part of the same different strands of the same thread that's sort of going after public institutions and trying to find literally any pretext to cut funding from them. And related to that, and like, you know, if there's no funding, it's clearly not being prioritized. When you're talking about dropout rates and stuff like that, if the schools are very clearly just being used as a daycare center and the safety ends up being in the hands of teachers who are then not being properly funded and then thus not being there, so that you end up with situations where the safety deterioration deteriorates and things are happening and people don't feel like they're even, their time is being wasted there, obviously they're going to not want to be there and go make money instead. It's just, it feels like they're failing to provide like any kind of real opportunities and then acting like, oh, see, nobody wants the things that we're offering them, and without actually taking a critical eye to what's actually being offered. And
Yeah, I agree. That's what was worrying me, is that I feel like a lot of people are giving up on the underlying idea of public education, that someone else's kid's education benefits you. It's not a perk they're getting from living in your town. It's something that the whole town is doing because it benefits all of us. And when that program started, the Student Opportunity Institute, I saw the meeting where it was first presented, and I believe I remember, and I haven't gone back to check this, so I apologize if I'm misquoting, but I remember Mrs. Al-Jamal, who's one of the school committee members, commenting that her parents were immigrants, and when they came here, they got help to learn a language and learn the culture while also having to learn stuff at school. And she was surprised to hear that Waltham didn't already have a program like this. And I thought that was a good point. The same thing, my dad's an immigrant. He came to Watertown in the 50s and he got help. It wasn't an official program. He just had a teacher who was nice and was willing to help. But most schools that have immigrant kids have some kind of programs to help them out. Actually, oddly, in her comments on the budget, the mayor mentioned that she had in the past recommended a night school to the school committee, but she didn't explain why it didn't happen. She also said she had visited a school in Somerville where they had a day program where some kids were still in the school, but it was like a separate program. And she saw that as a model, but then she never said what became of that. And what did they ever try to implement something like that? And, you know, it's disappointing to see people giving up on public education, because this area, the Boston area, we played such an important role in creating it and convincing the whole world that it could work. It's disappointing to see people here giving up on it. It's also disappointing to see people here having an attitude that, you know, there's a limit to what we can offer immigrants, because a big part of Boston has been welcoming immigrants who then become very important people in our country, especially when it comes to science and technology. A lot of the scientific advancements that made the US the dominant power throughout the 20th century, both in military and economics, happened here in the Boston area, and they were done overwhelmingly by immigrant scientists. Like my grandfather, the invention of radar happened mostly here, and that played a big role in the US winning World War II. The invention of signal processing happened here. It allowed the US to control huge networks of submarines and missiles in the Cold War. So much of that was done by immigrants, not just in science too. People like Khalil Gibran, who wrote The Prophet, Swami Vivekananda, who introduced South Asian philosophy to the United States. These were people who, they were immigrants, and because people here in the Boston area helped them, they were able to give something back to the whole country. And so I would really like to see us continue to have that attitude towards immigrants in the Boston area.
There's like the knee-jerk sort of xenophobia that is sort of just below the surface in America, and it's interesting seeing it come up in places like this.
Yeah, so there's a lot to talk about. If you watch those videos and you have things you think we should have brought up about the school budget that we didn't, let us know. But it is a done deal. The city budget and the school budget are now passed for the next fiscal year. So moving on, in the Public Works and Public Safety Committee, there were people there from the MBA to talk about buses. James, can you tell us more about that?
Yes. So this was in Public Works and Public Safety, and the MBTA was in attendance. They presented a plan for improved bus service for Waltham, in particular bringing the Waltham Center's 70 bus route into Boston, further into Boston, and also increasing the rate of the buses to get it down to like 15-minute service. So ideally, you wouldn't have to be checking a schedule to just be able to get on a bus to go to Boston. There was basically extended discussion around that, taking up most of the meeting with councilors. Councilor Darcy made a case for extending the 73, which is part of what had prompted starting this discussion in the first place. And he also took the opportunity to center getting more service in general for North Waltham. And the response was that they were sort of approaching this as a sort of a systems approach and sort of trying to take a holistic view of like transit into Boston from various locations, and they basically that they're hoping to make Waltham like a hub for getting into Boston is kind of like the idea by having this better service. One of the things they did mention though was an extension north-south, potentially past Waltham Center down Moody Street towards Newton as like a bone to throw for that type of thing. But it did sound like they'd be under discussion and that they could potentially iterate on this plan year over year. Following up with that was a discussion about buying property, One Brook Rd, which was also proposed originally by Darcy. That was with Chief Engineer Wynn, who discussed the usability of the property for flood mitigation in the Hardy Pond neighborhood. They had some back and forth on this and they were a bit pressed for time. And the takeaway was that there is going to be further investigation on the property was required. And that was basically the extent of the meeting.
That's exciting. I am a bus rider, so I take the 70, but I'm in favor of North Waltham having a bus. It's a very large residential area with no transit, and it definitely needs to get fixed.
They did bring up too that there's several new developments in that area happening, and that should potentially like, you know, prompt putting more service there, and that it's also, yeah, a pretty natural connection into Boston.
Two things that actually happened more than a week ago, but I didn't get to mention them in last week's show because we had a lot to talk about in last week's show. So I wanted to mention them now. One has to do with Alex Green, who you may know his name. He's a historian and a disability rights activist who lives in Waltham. And he had an op-ed in the Boston Globe a little over a week ago, which I recommend people check out. He is part of an effort to ask the Massachusetts legislature to pass a law that would preserve documents from the Fernald School and Met State and all the other institutions around the state. They are asking people to write in to your rep and your state senator to support that. There are a lot of important reasons to do that. One of them is that the families that a lot of the people who lived in those places were buried in unmarked graves. So their families have no way of knowing where they're buried or really anything about them if those documents aren't preserved. But another reason that Alex wrote about in this op-ed is he made the case that these documents are necessary to understand the history of eugenics, which is really interesting. For those who don't know, eugenics is a pseudoscience from the late 19th century that basically says that a race of people can and should improve themselves by preventing certain types of people from reproducing. Not based on science, it's basically the idea that biodiversity is bad, and science tells us that populations that have low biodiversity are that's a weakness. They're more likely to go extinct because biodiversity is what allows us to adapt to new situations, including new viruses. However, it was a very popular theory in the late 19th century because people were looking for ways to justify colonialism, and it was very popular among, you know, well-respected doctors and scientists and social reformers. So not surprisingly, a lot of them lived in Boston and were involved in the founding of the Fernald. And Alex makes the case that beyond that, eugenics was a big motivation for the creation of the institution system, that the main motivation for putting people in institutions was to prevent them from reproducing. Eugenics was used to justify the Holocaust and other atrocities in Nazi Germany. And in fact, during the Nuremberg trials, when Nazis went on trial as their defense, they said the eugenics program we were doing here is very similar to what you're doing in the United States with eugenics. So that gives a sense of what an ugly idea this is and how influential it once was in our country. And the reason I think that's important, the reason I'm giving a history lesson on a news show, is because there's a danger of it making a comeback. When you hear people joking about COVID is killing off the weak people or the old people, and maybe that's the silver lining, that's eugenics. When you see people online using the term degenerate to talk about queer people or anyone else they don't like, that's a language and a concept that comes from eugenics. So I hope support this effort if you can to get the documents preserved and check out that op-ed by Alex Green, because I think it's an important topic at this moment. The other thing I wanted to talk about is Maria Varmazis, who is the artist and cartoonist who you may know because we interviewed her in our special report about the attempts to ban queer books. She came in to give us some background on the books. And she is going to be going to Goddard Space Flight Center in next month in July to be one of the first people to see pictures coming back from the Webb telescope. She applied to do this, usually journalists apply, but she made the case that they needed an artist there, and NASA said, okay, you can come be the artist there. And this is a Webb telescope's a big deal for those who don't know. It is the successor to the Hubble telescope. It is in space right now, about 1 million miles away. It's already started sending us pictures, but they haven't got to Earth yet. They will get to Earth in a little over 2 weeks, and Maria will be there to see them. And the reason it's a big deal is because it will allow scientists to see much further into space than we have in the past. And that also means they're looking back in time much further than they ever have. And they may be able to see how the first galaxies and how the first stars were formed. So that's a big deal. And congratulations to Maria. We're looking forward to seeing what she comes back with from that trip. Moving on. Oh, so one more meeting. From this week, we need to talk about is licenses and franchises. Can you tell us about that, James?
Yeah, let me give you a quick summary. So license and franchises had National Grid and NSTAR in for several things. On the docket, one thing each. National Grid was in for Waverly and Trapello. They're installing a regulator on the sidewalk there. And NSTAR was there for installing conduit at Charlotte Road. And all of the other docket items were passed without much discussion. There was a thing on the Gold Star Families Bridge, which was getting renamed from the Gold Star Mothers Bridge to be more inclusive with families. So that was the memorialization that happened there. One of the other things that came up was off docket, so I don't have the exact address. I happen to miss that, but it's related to the road opening at the high school. I don't have more information there, but it sounded like it got pushed out at least another month potentially. So, but
that was on the bridge. When you say to be more inclusive of families, meaning like instead of just naming monuments after veterans, we should honor the whole family. Is that what you mean?
That was actually the thing that was cited, was that I guess in I don't remember the exact date, but it was under Barack Obama. They had changed it from being Gold Star Family, Gold Star Mothers specifically, to Gold Star Families, I believe, or at least the Gold Star Families designation was added under Obama. Okay. And this is basically catching up the monument to the federal.
So it was previously named for Gold Star Mothers?
Yep.
Got it. Okay, now that makes sense. Thank you.
Yes.
One last item, and unfortunately I don't have a ton of info on this, but there's a business called Pino Brothers Tattoos that's asking people to sign a petition. They are a tattoo business and they are in Cambridge, but they're from Waltham and they'd like to open up a branch in Waltham. And what they say on their social media is that they've been told by the city they can't do this because of a zoning issue. They have a specific place they want to do it because their family owns the building and they can't do it there because of a zoning issue. They didn't say what the issue was. So I kind of think there's probably no really good reason they can't do that. I would like to find out more about it, but I'd also like to support them. We will put a link to that too, to their posting online about that. And I think that's all we have for tonight. Am I missing anything?
That's it.
All right, thank you very much. We will be back next week with Chris Gamble and with some more news for you. Thanks a lot.
Bye, everyone.